Everybody, Professor John McMurtry.
Thank you. The global corporate experiment has failed. Existence on Earth is in rapid decline on every level of life organization. The air, the soil, and the water cumulatively degrade and disappear. The climates and oceans destabilize without connection. Species become extinct at a spasm rate across continents. And food polluters, songbirds, coral reefs, and large animals all crash at once. Public sectors and services are defunded and privatized as tax evasion by the rich multiplies. The global food system produces more and more disabling junk and wastes. Non-contagious diseases multiply to the world's biggest killer. The global financial system issues money out of control while collapsing in productive investment. The vocational future of the next generation is slashed across the world. Official lies and corruption are normalized as public relations. All the trends are one way, all are degenerate, and all are undeniable. Yet where are the dots joined? Where have you ever seen the dots joined? The common cause is taboo to name. Overpopulation is the stock explanation, but it blinkers out the causal mechanism altogether. Transnational corporate resource extractions, wastes, pollutions, and depletions of life-carrying capacities everywhere. It is not doubling world populations that poison and hollow out the world. The majority poor control only a fraction of the Earth's resources. What drives the end game is exponentially multiplying money, demand, and commodities with ever more wastes. They more than double every decade or few years, but global population rates halve as the damages still escalate. That educated people can go on blinkering out the actual causal mechanism while blaming the majority poor reveals the derangement of this ruling value system. Not even prophets like Chris Hedges decode it. Journalists are trained not to. Not even moral philosophers question the system worshipped, masked as the free market. Freedom means no accountability to human and world life, while competition means competing to externalize all costs onto the lives of citizens and environments. The value driver behind it all is no more questioned than the Almighty. It can do no wrong. But one underlying lockstep of false equations propels this unnamed war on the world through its mutations and metastases. And this is the source code, as they go on to call it. Rationality equals self-maximizing choice. That's just de rigueur. People don't know this outside the academy so much, but Peter certainly knows it. That's what rationality is, self-maximizing choice. You go from there, and then that means always more money for the self is good. So that's the ethic. Equals self-multiplying sequences of ever more money to the top as the ruling growth system. Equals all else is disposable means to this multiplying pathogenic growth. My 15-year study, The Cancer Stage of Capitalism from Crisis to Cure, which I think is posted there, diagnoses this ruling value mechanism as cancerous in principle. It is, in short, a deregulated self-multiplication of transnational money sequences accountable to nothing but their own multiplication with no committed life functions. With the Hayek-Reagan-Thatcher crusade to reverse the history of the world into a moronic free market and conservative values, the march was on. Marxists would not engage this great reversal on moral grounds because morality was believed to be only ruling class ideology. This left no life ground to stand upon. From the transnational victory of corporate world rule from 1991 on, reversals of social states were portrayed as market miracles, whatever the results for people's lives. The magic of the market was the new world religion, the end of history. The mass media were consolidated into one collective corporate organ across cities and borders. Death squads erased community oppositions in the South. The academy was and still is defunded to serve the global corporate market and commodity development. The nations of the world are all the while restructured to be subordinate functions to the supreme moral goal of transforming humanity and the world into ever more private commodities and profits. And again, I emphasize, it appears to be the most anti-moral system one can imagine, but in fact, it is a moral system and is defended as a moral system and through the notion of the free market and the self-maximizing atoms, optimizing consequences by an invisible hand that will necessarily turn out this way. It is a morality. It's a crazy morality, but it is one. It is an ethic, and in fact, that's where they ultimately go, what you see going on in Ukraine, for example, right now. They're going to the ultimate ethic, and the ultimate ethic are those series of equations I gave earlier. So society itself does not exist to this ruling value mechanism. They come right out and say it, but it's still a value mechanism. Its logic of growth is totalitarian and malignant to the marrow. More precisely, deregulated global corporate money sequences abolish by treaties and by wars all barriers, whatever, to their free multiplying growth through all that exists, whatever the destruction of natural and social life support systems. My work has been to decode this globally life-invading value system. Predictably, the diagnosis is taboo to mention in the press, however confirmed by the facts and the predictions. No social disorder ever allows its ruling program to be publicly unmasked. Thus, the malignant value code marches on. Alarm bells at the degenerate symptoms increase, but solutions only extend the system further and deeper. Life value economics is as unspeakable as the fatal disorder itself. Next section is called The Essential First Step in Winning the War of the World. Is comprehension of it. Only system analysis can lay bare the underlying value program, but it is avoided. The scientists do not study values and specialize. They talk about value theory and net value neutral, although they've got the most rigorous value system going, and specialize in domains of self-referential meaning. Journalists report facts, spectacles, and impressions, but not the underlying values governing them. Philosophers seldom analyze the ruling value system of the societies within which they live from social habit and from fear. In the age of instant culture, value system comprehension does not sell. Together, these blocks of normalized avoidance make the value code selecting for all the degenerate trends invisible to us. They're all predictable. As in immune system failure, the life host fails to recognize the disorder devouring it. Lacking any unifying framework of comprehension, people are lost. Thus, when millions rise in the Occupy Wall Street movement, there is no policy diagnosis or demand. Although Wall Street had indisputably defrauded masses and was on its knees, broke, and failed, no policy shift arose or was even proposed. That was what just threw me. Not even public control of the public money infusing the system cancer, $16 trillion at last count by Senate in the US alone. It's now nearing 30 trillion in the world. Trillion, 30, given to the banks to get them out of their failure. Well, everybody else, and you know where it's coming out of, all the social programs and, you know, austerity programs. And where do you see that connection made? It's not made in the mass media. Nor was there a movement for needed public mortgage system. Even after the private system had perpetrated the biggest fraud in history, indebted tens of millions of people into ruin, and collapsed the economies of the West into irreversible debt. The lost alternative of public banking, on which the US revolution was itself founded, Lincoln won the War of the Union, of union. North Dakota has had 100 years of debt-free prosperity. All of these are bank, public bank. We've already had public banks in all these cases, public banking. And again, I'll repeat them. The U.S. Revolution itself. The U.S. Revolution was over colonial script. That's what is explained, a little never talked about now, by Benjamin Franklin as why they had to go to a revolution. Because the Bank of England, private, canceled the right and had the cabinet on their side, because they were all investors, to withdraw all their colonial scrip by which they had been made very prosperous societies. And then they fell into a deep depression. So that was the first time. That was what the American Revolution was fought over. But how many people in this room know that or have even heard it? It's also the way Lincoln won the Civil War. The New York bankers wanted to charge 17 to 25% compound. He couldn't do that, so he issued the greenbacks as the currency of the land, of the realm, and that's how the war was won. And then guess what happened with Lincoln? And no one draws together those connections. But it's not just there. Inside North Dakota, for over 100 years, they've had a public banking system, and they have had public debt-free prosperity. The only country with, the only state with lower unemployment than any, lower debt than any, and so on. The West itself managed the 1939 to 45 war and the post-war years to unprecedented full employment. And first Japan, and now China, wins in productive investment. All is amnesiac in the West. That's why China's gone ahead. It has a public banking system right down to the municipal level. Never hear about that, do you? That's the amazing thing, how all this is kept taboo to know. Fast forward to today, and the underlying system cancer advances on. The financial giants causing the 2008 crash are bigger and richer in criminal impunity. They speculate with the publicly supplied trillions on food and water futures. They control even Rio Plus 20 as the life ground catastrophe they finance explodes on one front after another. Transfused with endless more public money to bleed and indebt the world dry, the money printing system metastasizes further, now occupying the once prosperous social democracies of the European Union, with public money bled out of people's lives and life bases to private banks with no limit. That's the fall of the European Union. Refusing any regulatory limits, converting pensions into more stock market feeding troughs, investing nothing into youth unemployment or employment, and with debt spikes ever higher for all, where does it all end? It ends when public money and human rights stop being fed to the failed system. All rights go to the transnational money sequence system through trade treaties. It ends when public money and human rights stop being fed to the failed system. It ends when commodity cycles of destructive waste are stopped. It ends at the base of the disorder when the 97% counterfeiting of debt and credit by private financial institutions is publicly controlled. Next section is economic doctrine allows money cancer system a free rein. Neoeconomic theory is a pseudoscience. Its defining postulates are unfalsifiable by facts. All organic, social, and ecological life requirements are absurdly assumed away. They don't exist. Infinite demand on finite resources is presupposed as sustainable. Mechanical reversibility of everything is taken for granted. Whatever does not fit the doctrine is rejected. Endlessly self-maximizing atomic selves, whether individuals or corporations, are believed to necessitate. This is actually the doctrine. This will necessitate the best of all possible worlds. That's just not my figure. That's what optimize means, the best of possible worlds. This is built right into the inner logic of the higher mathematics of market theory that you get all the Nobel Prizes for. They're all locked into it. And how does it necessitate the best of all possible worlds by self-maximizing atoms? By the invisible hand. Is this not a fanatic religion? Superhuman laws dictate commands across peoples. No deadly consequences lower certitude in the miracles of the market god. Even when the ruling value mechanism visibly depredates the very life bases of the world, the only reforms are to globalize it further. This is what I call a death spiral. Corporate lawyer treaties coined in secret rule as the new laws of nations, while hostile zones are subjected to covert forces sponsoring civil wars, as was promised after 9/11. We're going to destroy the following societies: Afghanistan, Iran. This is what Wolfowitz said, and was reported in the memoirs of Wesley Clark. Afghanistan, Iraq, Lebanon, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, Syria, all happened, and it's all happened since. And now the Ukraine, as I write. All is believed in and pursued as a world crusade, even a fascist lead it, as is occurring there. One supreme goal governs underneath bizarre beliefs. Multiplying growth of transnational money sequences at ever higher velocities and volumes with no limits tolerated. No blocks or impediments are allowed. This is the moral DNA of the ruling value mechanism. In theory, it is expressed well by University of Chicago professor and godfather of the U.S. National Security Council, Leo Strauss, who wrote in his canonical Natural Right in History, "Limitless capital accumulation is a moral duty and perhaps the highest moral duty." Again, you go back to this is a moral program, moral science. On the ground, Strauss's patron, David Rockefeller, expressed the moral political program more concretely at the turning point in 1991 as the Soviet Union fell. A supranational sovereignty of an intellectual elite and bankers is surely preferable to the national auto-determination practiced in past centuries, unquote. They're very clear about what the goal is. That's up in the web. If you look at that's up there. They don't shy away from what they intend and what they're doing. It's just the mass media don't carry it, and it's buried in right-wing websites like the Cato Institute is where I picked that up. Well, the promises are kept. There's no binding regulation to protect any life-carrying capacity on Earth from the loot-and-pollute money system in the years since. None. Many blame capitalism, but unlike classical capitalism, this mechanism is not driven by productive force development. It is driven by transnational money sequence multiplication. It's not just the exchange, it's the multiplication, the exponential multiplication that makes it cancer-like. With no productive standard, which despoils more means of life than it produces. Think of that. It destroys more means of life than it produces. It's clear. It eliminates the working class itself. It's not like classical capitalism. The ruling idea that the system is peerlessly productive is increasingly contradicted by far more life goods disappearing than are created. Something much more sinister is afoot. The social and natural life bases by which the human species evolves are reversed and overrun. Yet not even the opposition defines what ultimately counts, humanity's universal life necessities themselves. That's where we've got to start our ground. And you don't even find the concept. I've had to originate the concept. The meaning of the economy itself, to produce and distribute life goods otherwise in short supply through generational time, that's what a real economy is lost. Well, the very air humanity breathes is going more toxic and acidic. The contradiction to productive growth is unseen. As the waters of the world are simultaneously destroyed, the dots are not joined. Even as there are mass extinctions of species, youth without futures, and irreversible death servitude of the world, all is well if growth is returning to the system, which causes all of them. The Earth's very soil cover, taking tens of millions of years to evolve, is mined, acidified, salinated, degraded, and exhausted as forests, and mineral covers are stripped mined from one continent to the other, and there is no connected common meaning uttered among the peoples. The ruling value mechanism devours the life substance of humanity and the Earth itself, but remains assumed as ever more productive in its growth, even by angry unions who call for more growth and bargain on the basis of productivity. And as I'll go on to say, productivity is just producing for this cancerous system. Well, at least someone might reply, climate warming has been recognized by a Blue Ribbon Economic Panel, Britain's Stern Review, as the greatest and widest ranging market failure ever seen. It was very gratified to see him acknowledge that, because before then we basically had the assumed infallibility. This is a step towards rational observation. But even with a UN panel of over 1,600 scientists on the case, there is no connection to the other basic life capacities driven towards collapse by the same organizing value mechanism. No secret is more unspoken. So more rights to pollute and profit are instituted, and the climates and hydrological cycles spiral to more deadly extreme. The world's poor suffer first and most, Lord Stern also rightly observes, but this fits the reigning value mechanism. Those without money do not exist to it. Unmasking the ruling code of value, driving the war on life. I think it's ultimately a knowledge war, and that we live in a knowledge world, and knowledge is what's going to determine whether we sink or advance. Let us summarize. Behind every step of the great reversal lies failures of knowledge and value understanding. One, failure to diagnose the regulating value mechanism at work. Nowhere, really, down to exact principles determining its choices and decisions. Two, failure to connect across the domains of life to spoliation is predictable from the system's money sequence multiplication. That's why the second edition of this book came out. It's because everything it was predicting was coming true, but it doesn't make any difference as long as people don't know it. Three, failure to define or demand any public policies against its feeding on life support system, with public treasure supporting it every step. And four, failure to recognize any life value principle or the life ground of the economy itself. And number four is basically my life work, is what is formally called life value ontoaxiology, but I release you from having to remember that term. But what it means, literally, life value, everything of value is of life value, and that means of both on the ontological level, which means the logic of all being, all existence on Earth, and ontoaxiology means principles of value. So it's meant to carve out a universal, unlike our other thought systems, a universal referent that applies to all values whatsoever and all domains whatsoever. The knowledge blackout on this and everything else is understandable once one recognizes that the vaunted knowledge economy has no criterion from the start. All it means is what can be controlled, sold, or manipulated to grow the ruling value mechanism. Pause on that general fact. This is why true knowledge is so often denied or attacked as uncompetitive. Look for exceptions to this spread of the ruling money value mechanisms into the very capacities of human understanding. Really, knowledge has been the first victim here at the level of the ruling value mechanism. And right into the universities, right into the schools, right into the mass media, right into public programs, right into CBC, everywhere. It's dominating. Who even now recognizes that new efficiencies, reforms, and cost-cutting are always attacks on people's lives, means of life, and life functions? Who connects across the one-way falls of life standards and regulations, public science and testing, agrarian communities and lands, workers' rights and unions, social infrastructures and protections, and social life security across populations, while money demand multiplies out of all control at the top? See, it's a predictable system. It's a cancer system. Who names the innermost ruling code driving all? Whatever protects or enables human and ecological life is eliminated as a barrier to private money sequence multiplication. This is the source code of the cancer system. It explains why transnational corporate equity and bank profits grow to ever new records as the world's majorities are dispossessed. It explains why social and natural life capacities are despoiled across continents. The war on life is built into this system. The ideals of freedom, democracy, and economic growth are thus reversed in the name of them. The big lies, and reversals really, the big lies become so automatic that few notice them. For example, as I write, food stamp slashes reducing 47 million hungry U.S. people below $1.40 a meal for children and others, and $90 less a month for them for life necessities, quote, and this is Obama, protects the most vulnerable Americans, unquote. Well, he's doing it, that's what he says he's doing. And that's Obama, who sort of seems like a sort of middle-of-the-road guy. He's a symptom of the system. That was just January 29th. There's a recourse against lies which is as old as the species. Humanity's deciding evolutionary advantage is that knowledge wins in the end. It's about the only law you can give about society. Above all, knowledge evolves through recognition of how life is disabled or enabled by material conditions and social rules. For example, the binding abolition of the most profitable commodity of world trade ever thought impossible at the time, human slaves. Won. It's still won. Knowledge won again from the 1929 crash and subsequent World War, when the collective life security of peoples evolved by known facts and social policies more in 30 years than the past 25 centuries. Knowledge being applied. The missing link for this long life and death struggle is the life value code. I almost get into a sideline about supply and demand and what, you know, why Keynes was rejected and so forth, because supply must equal demand. It's the basic axiom of the whole system of understanding. Therefore, everything he talked about was illusory or wrong. Anyway, the missing link for this long life and death struggle is the life value code. We do not know it because we are without a reference body in a vast ocean of self-maximizing money sequences for which the goods are only what sell for private profit. A life-bound compass almost emerged after 1945 when people recognized how ruling delusions of self-maximizing fanaticism almost destroyed civilization. They were variations on the same theme. You know, the Wall Street bankers and so forth, self-maximization without limit, huge inequalities and so forth, and then a more fanatic, openly fanatic version of it in Nazism, but they were both self-maximizing, both to go to the top, both with no limit, both all as, and both with complete blindness to other people's lives having any value. A life ground and compass almost arose after that, because societies forged binding international covenants for collective life security and free human development. I mean, none of you know about them probably because they've been so well repressed, but there's a binding covenant, an economic, social, and human rights that makes all that we are fighting for to save, that is any social infrastructure to save life, as a binding obligation on all states who signed the agreement, which are all the major states of today. Just been swept out. It's lawless. This system is lawless at the international level. Universal education, health, and income security infrastructures were publicly formed across societies under international law, but no unifying value code underlying them was found. In absence of any sound life base of understanding to reground in, the great reversal from 1980 on has gone from one extreme of life blindness to the next, with endless lies of better days to come. even as there is ever more joblessness, and always one way, ever more joblessness, meaningless unemployment, meaningless employment, deprivation of more majorities of peoples, commodity diseases across the globe still increasing. Debt servitude increasing like the one from obesity and diabetes, that's all new. That's only in the last few years since junk foods. Debt servitude chaining the futures of people more indebted now than ever. We can't be paid. And deep, as a Wall Street banker said once, there's no one's ever going to pay their debts. They're just going to pay their payments on time. And that's the way it's set up. There isn't enough legal tender in the world to cover a fraction of the debts that are owed to the banks. And deepening ecocidal trends, the worst, advancing one way with the system's growth. Locked into the ruling frame of thinking, people blame humanity. Oh, humanity, what's happened for the catastrophe unfolding? But even as the demands of the ruling value mechanism have been imposed every step on humanity and societies, they've been imposed. None of it's really been agreed to. By, first of all, secretly negotiated and adjudicated, also of a secret panel that's unappealable beyond, that judges these things, above nations, above laws, unappealable, very seldom known by people, which is the transnational corporate system that is backed by, lest you wonder how do they make people do things, it's backed by global force, financial sabotage, and embargo, the key one, and huge penalties go running into the hundreds of millions of dollars a day if you don't obey. And no one voted for it. It was secretly coined. As of right now, the Trans-Pacific Partnership right now is being secretly codified and then will be imposed. From secret codification by corporate lawyers of treaties overriding constitutions themselves to free looting of human and natural life capacities across borders, ever more money sequence investor rights are prescribed and multiplied across nations. Those who resist are against competition or are terrorists. Reverse projection always rules. I always blame the other for what you're doing as the reason for attacking it. An absurd metaphysic is assumed throughout. The economy's provision of goods through time mutates to laws of supply and demand that are fatuous or caricatures of both. Demand is not people's needs or necessity, the real demand. It is private money demand minted by private banks without legal tender to back it to indebt people and gamble on their future means of life. That's what they're talking about, demand. Not really demand. Supply, similarly, is not the life means people require to survive and flourish. It is ever more priced commodities for profit, promoting more human and ecological well-being across continents. The supreme moral value of the system is then equated to its opposite as well. Freedom equals freedom for private money demand only, equals in proportion to the amount controlled, equals ever less freedom for those with less of it, equals no right for life for those without it. When mass uprooting, joblessness, and misery follow, more reverse meaning is proclaimed. Uplifted out of poverty, headlines proliferate over a money gain equal to the cost of a coffee for subsistence farmers who have been forced into city slums without any means of natural and communal life support left. They're said uplifted out of poverty because they've got money to spend equivalent to a Coke a day. Peoples are too distracted by competition for vast prizes to notice the key distraction, Olympics, Super Bowl. The global struggle for life is displaced by ever more contest spectacles as global mass marketing sites, the meaning now of sport. But behind the perpetually revolving mirrors, the meaning is taboo to see. People may see greed of the rich, but not that greed is the global system's driver at every level. More productivity is liked across classes, but who sees that it only means less cost per unit of profitable commodities, bringing more life waste and destruction? Workers and left thinkers may no more want to see this than the corporate press. If you point this out about productivity, they don't want to publish it because their interests depend on the delusion. The meaning of the free market itself is reversed. And Peter talked a lot about the free market. I mean, it isn't really a free market. I go back to the classical. Over centuries, the free market has meant the opposite of the global corporate system. Public places of local life goods, right? All opposite to what's going on at the global level. All exchange for legal tender, opposite. Featuring real foods and crafts, mostly opposite. No mass conditioning ads, opposite. No debt super servitude, opposite. No dominance of transnational money sequences. No throwaway packages and waste. No lobbies controlling governments. No invisible head offices pulling puppet strings. And no bribery controlling supply and demand. It's not a free market at all. Yet the free market, like the real economy, is overwhelmed, just as in a cancer. There are only more absentee money sequences with no required life functions or accountability to the communities and life conditions they competitively bleed. That's what the competition is about. How fast they can get the money from the public, competitively draining them, hollowing them out, and that's what the competition means. But the life and death choice cannot be made without knowing both. I'm sorry. The enemy is undefined. The common life capital it attacks is unknown. Both the life and death choice cannot be made without knowing these, who the enemy is and what the solution is. The life value turn, then, is the next stage of civilization. Reality hides in the language of the past. So capitalism is blamed by critics when real capital is in fact destroyed at every step. Journals report global wealth has soared 68% in 10 years, but life wealth is devoured as fast as the money sequence system can grow. Always the underlying life ground is lost beneath the competitive self-multiplication of the money demand invading all that exists. With no life value anchor and compass, the degenerate trends only deepen beneath reference body to recognize what they are. And I've spent most of my life as a professional philosopher on the problem of life value and social value systems. Although the sane may agree life value is what ultimately matters, nothing has been less understood. People called pro-life usurp the woman's body in the name of fundamentalist religions. Nations absurdly assume that standard of living is measured by the private money spent. Animal rights theory has no criterion to tell the life value of a snail from a person. Life sciences, all in quotes, sacrifice billions of animal lives a year for private money value gain, just about all of it. New and better technology has no life value standard to decide better from worse. Life value is the missing base. We really must get that one clear. But there are as many proxies for life value as there are values. Specialist domains like physiotherapy and medicine recognize life value in organic functions, but without principled meaning to apply to wider life systems. In general, life value ignorance defines our age. This is how the greatest of all fatal confusions has mutated, that money sequence growth equals life value growth. That's at the core of the whole cancer system. Just as the multiplying grotesque cancer cells eating the life host alive are not recognized on the micro level, so too on the social level of life organization. The proliferation, in fact, the exponential proliferation of banknotes of bets, credit, and debt without legal tender drive financialization across the planet more daily than all of GDPs of the countries of the world put together over a year. They must loot life and life bases to keep growing without inflation, as trillions of new dollars are printed without life function. How are you going to have more and more money chasing fewer and fewer life goods? Well, just take it away from everybody else. So endless slashing of life goods and wages, benefits, social security, pensions, and environmental protections result as money demand powers multiply at the top. This is why endless bonuses for financial failure, stripping of the middle classes and the poor, squandering of public wealth on rich corporations, the list can go on, are demanded as U.S. led wars for resources, new lands, and corporate markets never stop, and taxes on the rich are reversed. all predictable from the metaprogram. All is predictable once the cancer system is diagnosed. An ultimate question thus arises. What is the ground of response to this ruling value mechanism which cumulatively plunders human and other life to feed itself? We know the ultimate ground is life value, but what is life value? The objective standard and measure can be defined in three steps. All value whatever is life value. Two, good versus bad equals the extent to which life is more coherently enabled versus disabled. So it's basically enabling life, coherently enabling life value, or disabling it. It's good and bad, and it admits of degrees, by greater, lesser ranges or capacities of thought, felt being, and action through time. Those are the three fields of life that include all that is of value in life. And it all can be, the thing is, with the life value theory or understanding, you have no problem of difference of opinions because it's objective. It has objective measures too that nobody can coherently disagree with. The thing is, we haven't got down there for all the reasons I've been stating. Well, of course, we've had visions of world peace, the classless flourishing of people's lives, more equality, a planetary ecology in which humanity is its conscious understanding. All these ideals express this underlying life code of value. But who decides, skeptics ask? No one decides, because gains and losses in life capacity, that's the key, life capacity, are as objective as the laws of biology and medicine. Anything is better or worse by the greater or lesser range of life capacities it enables. It's almost worth remembering. Anything is better or worse by the greater or lesser range of life capacities it enables. Applies everywhere. This value code is built into evolution itself. I'm not inventing anything. I'm decoding. It is no matter a matter of opinion than people's life necessities are. And what is a need? What is a necessity? It's that without which life capacities are always reduced. It's objective. The ruling value mechanism is the polar opposite. It attacks life and life conditions everywhere as vehicles to its self-multiplying growth. Because this growth is assumed to be life value, however, the greatest value reversal in history goes unnoticed. The three-step life code of value provides the generic life value compass and base which has been missing. It is objective because it is true independent of anyone's perception of it. It has unlimited validity because there is no exception to it, which is testable by searching for one. It is presupposed in value judgments, as you can observe whenever these judgments are defended. They always end up, if they're saying it somehow protects or enables life. Life value is also universalizable because all values derive their worth from it. Finally, life value is sovereign because it trumps any other value in cases of conflict. All of these are testable generalizations. I've written three volumes for UNESCO, by the way, on this. But what of measure or more or less life value? Life value is measurable in degrees by greater or lesser capacities of thought or felt being and action shown through time. For example, how much life capacities gain or lose by nourishing versus junk foods. Today, the macro trends are in one-way loss of life capacities. Knowledge is the exception. It forms the way stations of life understanding passed on to others and subsequent generations across epochs, the distinguishing life capacity of the human species. But even knowledge is threatened by corporate rights against its dissemination at the same time as there is mass propagation of public lies. New electronic communication capacities without corporate control still win the war by the greatest civil community development in history, the internet. But the life and death fields of invasion by the ruling money value mechanism are not decoded. The money tides of hit and run buying and selling of lands and currencies across the world, free and growing use of ecocidal extraction methods, life-starring hours and wages, no benefits and global dispossession. Oh, it goes on. It's so despairing. lethal arms trading, oil guzzling and noise polluting vehicles of multiplying kinds, big oil and big pharma, looting of public lands and health dollars. Always it's looting public wealth. It can't go a step without it. At the cost of hundreds of millions of people, and most invisibly, full-spectrum assault on humanity's thinking and feeling sides of being alive, living itself, the zombie effect. Where, we might ask, do the transnational money sequences not destructively invade the evolved fields of life of humanity and fellow species? Exponentially multiplying money sequences eat away at the margins of every private transaction, public funding, life exchange, and substance with and across borders. Consider all the bites every moment across business and exchange sites. Beyond the carrying trade and exploiting lower interest rates in one country to flood another with cheaper money advantage, you know, what's doing Venezuela in right now. Beyond the trillions in derivatives betting every day, beyond the raids on sovereign currencies and bonds, all of this should be illegal, it used to be, without tax or regulation. On the local level, hardly a shop, a buyer, a builder, a home dweller. This was pointed out to me, by the way, by a Zeitgeist member who's a professor of physics. He says, look at it. On the local level, try to look anywhere, any exchange, any step, a buyer, a builder, I'm putting it in a summative language, a home dweller. Anybody who lives today is not invaded by the same financial mechanism, with ever more rights to demand at every exchange site with no function, while enforcement is paid by the public being stripped by it. The apparently free credit card system, for example, and few will know this, imposes a 2% charge to the seller for sales at a hidden 33% annual debt charge rate before the debt predation even sets in. There's no end to the invisible lines of life-devouring demands now moving deeply into higher learning, into public health themselves. I mean, hospitals are governed and universities, they're not governed by their constitutions anymore. They're governed by how much revenue they bring in. That's governed in turn by boards of managers who are themselves corporate executives, and on it goes. On to the wars themselves, where we have destabilizations from which fire prices can be extracted from the societies, and societies are destroyed deliberately for this reason. They have no means of defense against the stripping of them then. How else would a cancer system behave? So if you think of it, this model, it's an explanatory model, not a metaphor, how else would it, if it's true, or if, you know, you just want to test its truth, how else, if you were going to have a cancer at a social level of life organization, how else could it behave than the way it's behaving? Always one way. Always disabling. The world deciding choice begins with what you buy. Clearly, for example, eating, selling, or supplying junk foods is objectively bad to the measure it disables human life and produces global epidemics of obesity, heart failure, cancer, and diabetes, which it does. Yet even economic science calls them all goods. It's written right into the textbooks. They're all goods. Newspapers call them all goods. I mean, this immense presupposition against fact goes without notice. Whatever the rising disease effects. Simultaneously, violence entertainments flood public airwaves and play spaces as the same consumers, most avidly the young, they are seeing flooding images of humanity being killed, tortured, injured, humiliated. And as the sugar lard, salt concoctions are ladled into bloodstreams and throwaways clog the earth's circulatory channels at the same time, we begin to see the multiplying destructive occupation of the fields of life and life substance as built into these runaway growths and their goods. Life capacities at every level are attacked as market as market freedom. Only life value ground and measure can penetrate the disease, none define. And this is, hope I don't run out of voice. to addictively disable human life capacities for more transnational money sequences through ever more lives from infancy onward. Addictively disable. That's the secret to all these commodities, as far as they can take it. Where is their exception? Life activity replacing motors and commercial games, endless unneeded and non-cyclical, non-recyclable conveniences, locking into habits of life, political junkie election images and spectacles, where the truth is what sells, corporate candidates and commercial internet and television hooks everywhere in front of which children spend 11 hours a day. Which of any of these is not geared to addict consumers, to compulsive consumption against their life capacity development? What does not input toxic waste into the circulatory flows of ecosystems at the same time? But all is optimal for the ruling economic model for which life and society are reduced to atomic desiring machines, propelling more money demand to money controllers as the nature of the growth the official world always calls for. And by the way, these words about humans as desiring machines, that's written right into neoclassical economics. They're desiring machines that seek to maximize, and that's all. And this is the way you manufacture consent, is by getting hold of that desire level and selling to them and requiring them to work for it. The moving line of the true war of liberation begins with what we are able to control, our own lives. Consider your own life, what you know best. Every value you enjoy, lose, or gain has a bottom line, in life capital. What enables life to reproduce and grow rather than degrade and stagnate through time. We defend it and our health by buying life goods and nothing else. The turning point is as old as physical and cultural evolution. Every human advances by knowing what enables life from what does not. Collective life advances transmitting this life and death knowledge across selves and generations. The life value code holds across all cultures. But the universal life goods and necessities are not even known. Their meaning is obscured everywhere, but they are exactly definable. Life goods are always that without which life capacities decline and die. All real needs are known by this criterion. Every human life suffers and degenerates towards disease and death without, and here are the universal life necessities of human beings, without breathable and unpolluted air. And think of I'm not going to be able to spell out how every one of them is under attack. Breathable and unpolluted air, clean water and waste cycles, nourishing food and drink, protective living space, supportive love, health care when needed, a life-coherent environment, symbolic interaction itself, and meaningful work to perform. All these are measurable in sufficiency across cases, and all people have these universal human life necessities. Yet all universal human life needs and capacities are at the same time attacked, unknown, attacked, polluted, or perverted by the ruling value mechanism in product, process, and lobby demand across the world. I could tell a story, and in fact have written pages and pages and pages in detail of how every one of them is taken apart and destroyed. Yet where are the universal life needs themselves even named and connected against the malignant growth system spreading through every more nose? Well, not zero growth, as some people are wanting to say now, but zero bad growth is the way. A real economy, by definition, regulates for what these universal life necessities require and against toxic junk, and the individuals would not buy 99% of these corporate commodities if they followed this principle. Victory or loss in the war of the world lies in how we live. So why does anyone buy such commodities? System addiction is how it grows, and knowledge what life goods versus bad is the through line of the good life and of human evolution itself. What deeper motivation could there be? And then I just add with the end of this section, I, like many others, have long lived without corporate ad television. without habitual private use of gas vehicle use of any kind, any junk food or beverage, any throwaway item, any new fashion or commodity not more life-enabling than the old, or business, any business with private banks, selecting for life goods at the local level. The organizing principle is the spirit of the Tao Te Ching and the free autonomy of the wise, back to the Stoics. It is as old as the good life. The life code formula is clear: minimal market demand to enable life capacities to flourish. The value imperative, this value imperative, defines transformation to true economy and liberates life wherever it moves. And now I move to the final and the key sort of original section that I hadn't done so much work on before. And it's on collective life. Collective life capital is the common value ground and measure across divisions. We know the war of the world can be won. The plague addiction to corporate cigarettes has been conquered by most of the developed world's population. I mean, the addiction, you know, I've talked to a psychiatric witness on this. Cigarettes are worse than heroin, a specialist told me, in terms of addiction. And yet, the most people have kicked it. Well, they can do that with that. They can do it with this system. This shows how the life code can select against habituated system harms of the most compulsive kind, and everybody live better from what is done. At the personal level, it begins with zero-based accounting, with money demand only justified by life-enabling gain. Yet for collective life goods, we do not have a principled ground and measure. It's the great terra incognita of modern economic thought. Collective life capital does not exist in public or expert meaning. Any common life interest or agency at all is excluded unless it promotes profits. The implications are fatal, but unseen. Collective provision of the universal human life necessities that have evolved through long social organization and human evolution are blinkered out by the ruling value mechanism. It sees only mechanical growth by commodity sales and profits. Everything that makes a society civilized or livable is blinkered out. Common water and sewage systems for all. All of these are going to be blinkered out a priori. Because of game theory, one of the ways, well, I could get again, go very deep with this, and I do in that book. Common water and sewage systems, free movement pathways and life spaces without cost to use. Our sidewalks, for example, the bicycle paths that I use every day, public libraries with unpriced books and films, nonprofit health care and disease prevention by public institutions. All of these are collective life capital that don't exist within the ruling model, and that's why they're always defunded. Public income security from disemployment, old age, and disability. Life protective laws, including sufficient minimum wages and environmental regulations. Primary to higher education without multiplying debts. Family housing, food, and means of life assistance for children without parental money. Yet all of these are defunded or eliminated to pay debt services to private banks and grow business, with the IMF to the Tea Party, leading the charge as new efficiencies and savings. From this built-in erasure of common life ground, the hollowing out of collective life goods proceeds without any feedback correction. Public wealth is privatized at every level to feed corporate money sequences, and they all think they're doing the right thing. Listen to our finance minister. Thus fed with endless giant tax and subsidy handouts and deregulations to invade further, the demands of the ruling value mechanism continue to multiply. The collective life base to steer by and to regulate by does not exist. For example, even at the high levels of the best economic theorists, for example, when Amartya Sen entitles his Nobel laureate monograph, Social Choice, I was hoping, oh my, he's going to get into it. Even he can get no further than atomic aggregates of individual preferences, even Amartya Sen. No collective life goods in themselves are conceivable within the market paradigm. when another progressive economist, Eleanor Ostrom, wins the Nobel Prize for Economics years later for her book, now advising Obama, and her book is called Governing the Commons, the Evolution and Institution of Collective Action. Well, I was again looking so forward to reading this, but she's trapped within the same paradigm. No principle of common life interest or agency beyond mutual self-advantage can even be conceived by her. The commons and collective action she posts on the cover of her book, but no civil commons or agency is seen from universal health care to a public bicycle path. Common-based life bases can no more compute through the ruling prism than the collective actions required to provide them. And that's why it's all being dismantled. In fact, the underlying problem is ancient. We have lacked a common life ground since the genocides of the first peoples began. It is a very ancient blind spot which has become, they don't lack a common life ground. A very ancient blind spot which has become increasingly fatal with all powerful technologies of destruction and the deranged money value code driving all of them. The eco-genocidal streak goes deep. From the Old Testament tribal god command to exterminate all other peoples in Palestine, to millennia later, the first peoples in the New World saying to their modern invaders, when all the trees have been cut down, when all the animals have been hunted, when all the waters are polluted, when all the air is unsafe to breathe, only then will you discover you cannot eat money. There's a long story to that quote, which I guess I don't have time to tell you. Even comes from Crowfoot, and it was given to me originally by the UNESCO Secretariat when they were dealing with the work I was producing for them. Even these things get around. Even life, liberty, and freedom in the U.S. Constitution reduces to the Commerce Clause and corporate rights by Supreme Court interpretation. There is no public interest. There is no public common interest inside the U.S. Constitution. That's what it reduces to. And this is by way of an agreement with a professor of constitutional law who's working on it with me. Abdication of life responsibility is built into the system. The global market God rules, and the common life interest and its agencies do not exist. How are we to ground beneath this life-blind paradigm whose global mutations threaten to evolve life on Earth? In the end, the organizing principle crosses the lines of death itself, the life code of value at the collective level. But this common life interest is usurped in its very name. This is why, for example, the young can be killed in masses, and arms budgets bankrupt U.S. public sectors to enrich big oil, or why people's homes can be expropriated for private developers in the U.S. as in the public interest by eminent domain. This is the dark side of history, one oppressor rule after another. But the collective life interest is the true bottom line of legitimate governance. The proof is in the conditions of its definition. So here's where it's defined. It must be consistent with the life-carrying capacities of all through time. It must be open to life-enabling change. It must go deeper than family, gender, or culture differences. It must include past as well as future generations. It must supersede the ruinous man-nature, economy-environment splits, and individual-society duality of interests. It must realize the three R's of ecological literacies to be life coherent. It must bridge the past to the present to the future as one process to steer development beyond the holocausts of history. It must embody the economic principles of efficiency, productivity, and innovation in life-serving terms. It must make all freedom responsible to its life conditions of possibility. It must embed the life bases of all as supreme, so it cannot, in principle, go wrong. Such a moral code seems impossible. Every demand of the ruling value mechanism is structured against it. Opposing ideologies do not find its common life base. Postmodernism and relativism deny there is any universal principle of value except the actual ruling one that they obey. Political policies are confined to what serves the corporate market system. Issue politics fixates on sexual preferences. There is no common life ground recognized or life value compass to steer by. Collective life capital regrounds us. It is the life base of the common interest, that without which humanity's life capacities degrade and die. It is the bridging concept across the economy environment division, as well as across present and future generations. It is the true meaning of economic necessity and the sole substance of growth and development. And all collective life capital transcends all divisions by impartial principles that cannot go wrong. One, by a unifying life value regulator enabling all. Two, a generic life value measure to tell greater from lesser by margins of capacity loss or gain in any domain or case. Three, production of more life value capacity through generational time. Four, cumulative life gain as the organizing goal of the process throughout. Make the world a better place. Five, the more coherently inclusive and enabling life, the better it is. In this way, the common interest is provided an exact progressive meaning. It can be measured all the way down the line, and it already is in medicine, for example, with health and disease. And collective agency, so here we get both the exact progressive meaning of the collective or common life interest, and the collective agency is built into its logic of life progression. You know, a huge issue about collective agency. There is, you know, not trying to find it. The collective life capital builds the agency into its concept. Conversely, whatever person, group, or system destroys common life capital is objectively evil to the extent of life capacity destruction through time. For example, corporate U.S. oil wars or leisure vehicles destroying natural life. Advancing life, collective life capital, in contrast, is what makes the world a better place. This is what it means. It could be by cures to diseases, more ecological methods, life infrastructure building, advancing knowledge, new ways of seeing, or life protective laws. I don't know whether I mentioned new ways of seeing, I would say our Peter does that across the world. All more inclusively enable life without loss and with cumulative gain. No real progress is ever made without satisfying this logic of value. Feeling with across species and tribes, for example, may bind many of us in this room. So too, even more, advancing life-coherent knowledge and visual comprehension, as Peter's films do. The understanding and feeling sides of life keep extending despite all that I've talked about, despite death and moral numbing by the ruling value mechanism. Public knowledge via the internet commons wins against corporate media silencing and propaganda. We see here the underlying struggle across the fields of life. The rising and falling of life capital basin compass can be found, in fact, in every social policy decision or movement that goes right or goes wrong. That's the key, that's the axis. There is no exception. The war of the world is everywhere, and so is our task of life commons understanding and building. This is not hope without substance. The common life interest is already built into our lives over millennia without our knowing it. The civil commons of language itself, collective water sources and sewage, common safety regimes, shared pathways everywhere, community health rules and healing sites, everyday life-enabling knowledge institutions and practices at every level. All are these are life capital formations that keep advancing beneath notice despite and through diseases and wars. Unseen, too, is that all are more threatened now by the ruling value mechanism than ever before in history. Their defining general meaning is all social constructs which enable universal access to life goods. This, too, is no utopian ideal. It is the measure of all true development across all cultures before and after our own lives. From environmental economy to universal libraries and education, to public water and waste cycles, to life-serving laws before which all are equal. These are all forms of collective capital already in continuous development, but all are attacked bite by bite by the multiplying money sequence system now out of control. Excuse me for a second. The collective life capital developments that are needed now are many, but they can be crystallized into three system shifts in general. One, public banking for credit and investment in individual and life capital growth. We have to have public banking. Back to the only, it's the only thing that's ever worked. It's the only thing that's working now. Two, ecological quotas for all consumption of non-renewable energies and materials. I mean, they've worked too, what's often called rations. Three, citizen income security guaranteed in return for life-enabling service, life-enabling hours of public service. Movements of masses to demand them completes knowledge in public action. Under the ruling value mechanism today, in contrast, evolved life on Earth is under totalizing attack. 95% of all gains go to 1% with no required life function, while 95% of the world's life support capacities are pillaged by their life-blind money sequences. Yet life value steering is easier than not. Norway, for example, has led the world in holding on to and advancing its common life capital basis throughout this system sickness. I could tell stories there too. And emergent Latin America is implicitly building collective life capital deciders from decades of death squad and foreign money sequence ruin. Before the Great Reversal, societies everywhere were becoming governed by public policy patterns of similar kinds. National recovery of control over publicly owned resources, progressive taxation, public banking and investment, and policy-led elimination of structural depredation of the poor and the environment. All of these are being followed by Latin America right now. All have been followed throughout the success of the Scandinavian countries, and all have been followed when Canada was successful. All are methods of collective life capital formation, inclusively enabling the lives of individuals across time. Inclusiveness is a concept which is much invoked today, but without the life capital basis and compass required in the real world, it is empty rhetoric. Let us overview the condition we face. Once upon a time, and I'm almost through, once upon a time in the distant past, capitalist organization under public control mass-produced healthy food, clothing, and utensil commodities despite brutally exploitive methods. Back in the heyday of Adam Smith. There was a long, painful taming of it over 200 years, and then the Great Reversal from 1980 on usurped progressive social development at every level possible. Since then, the private transnational money sequence system has been increasingly deregulated to competitively multiply and override all life-carrying capacities, propelling endless wars, public and public sector debt, slavery, mass disemployment, and majority disposition for obscene riches, and so forth. This is the global cancer system, which occupied states now subsidize, enforce, and grow as fast as they can, stripping the soils and forests, poisoning the waters, disemploying peoples. Every day it's another vector, and producing disease-causing junks in greater volumes. Regrounding and common life capital, however, exposes every one of these disorders and connects them and directs solution to them. The long missing base and measure of what was once called the moral science. It resets evolutionary theory itself, in which only self-gene multiplication counts. It's an interesting thing, the biological correlative of the self-multiplying money mechanism. Self-maximizing game theory dominates both, and military doctrine, justice, and moral analysis besides. Yet common life capital bases are excluded from all of them as the lost life ground and reference body
of our capsizing planetary condition. New natural and social capital categories may seem to assist us here, but they only repeat the vicious circle. Natural capital is what can be exploited for more money. Human capital is more future private money demand for its owner. Social capital is lower transaction costs for profit. Physical capital follows suit. Life capital remains without a name. Collective life capital does not exist. All must be steered back into conserving and producing life goods rather than destroying them, the ultimate policy imperative of the world. The public authority, policies, rights, and subsidies to issue sovereign money now lavished upon the like destructive mutations of private money capital thus can end without a shot fired. They are now so dependent on counterfeit money sequences given to them by the public, on treaty edicts given to them by the public, on public handouts and resources and natural resources, they can't go a day without public support all the way down. The public needs only to reclaim them and not to take a thing. It's not about dispossessing, it's about the public reclaiming what it has and has been usurped. Let the market decide, all money interests cry. This ruling superstition is more barbaric than any before. Essentially, ever more for those with more money to suck the lifeblood out of humanity and the earth dry. Its ruling delusion is that the best of all possible worlds must follow by an invisible hand. In fact, a deregulated global chaos of private transnational money sequences exponentially multiply while the world of life capital and goods is cumulatively destroyed. The life capital alternative is self-evident once seen. It grounds in common life capital, life wealth that produce more life wealth without loss and new gains for successive generations. Its moral logic is in fact the through line of all human development since language and the cooperative provision of means of life. Unlike the global market of atomically self-maximizing corporations devouring the world for more profit extraction, The delusion that an unseen hand directs all to the best, collective life capital steers across divisions by an objective and universal life value base and measure in exact progression which cannot, as life coherent, go wrong. I keep emphasizing that because always moral theories have somehow gone wrong in political theories. This one, why? Because they've been life destructive. This one has it built into it that it can't be life destructive, it must be the opposite. The unifying principle is already implicit in the architecture of modern human thought. All that is lacking is life value, ground, and measure. They connect life, the ultimate ontoethical concept, to capital, the ultimate concept of political economy. And so by transitivity to law, human rights, sustainability, and intergenerational equity, the meaning is clear. Valid law is a collective life capital formation providing the rules to live by that coherently protect and enable human life. Human rights themselves are instituted claims to what enables their life capacities to be realized as human. Sustainability is of collective life capital or it is a fraud. Intergenerational equity is access to collective life capital across generational time without loss, or it is a lie. Throughout, we see a missing life base presupposed, but not yet conscious or defined. Throughout, we see that the ruling money sequence value mechanism is incompetent even to comprehend it. Building without loss and for better life across generations is what is ultimately earth worthwhile. No, it's in your mother's milk, really. No one might deny it, but ignorant usurpation of its meaning is what rules us. All universally life-enabling progression of human evolution in history to now are the result of its implicit understanding. You cannot take a clean breath, meet a child safely, enjoy a drink of water without their support from the past. The warped streak of epics and histories of power is opposite. But even state mass murderers and Wall Street bankers think they are improving the world. It's built into their value system, false value system. The primary delusion which received theory rationalizes so that few understand. The lost life ground is already implicit in healthy lives. Our organic fitness and powers, our depth and breadth of knowledge acquisition, our abilities to perform productive tasks of needed kinds, and most of all, our sustained intent to create more life wealth without loss and cumulative gain are the generic parameters of a life code which is already built into us as human. More than ever, we know the plague is ruling, and the 1% and the 90% express it. But a real economic holds beneath opinions and times. Public investment in common life capital capacities is the only allocation that works over time. We know this from America and Canada before 1980, Germany, Japan, Korea after 1950, and the post-1945 age of social standards across the world. It has been proven again, despite sabotage coups and financial strangulations in Latin America after 1999. The unseen enemy is borderless money sequence with ever more rights. The missing map is diagnosis of the ruling value cancer. The missing link is the life capital economy, all now live and move by, breathe and move by. The war of the world today is won by knowledge action. Please, sir.
There are many things I could ask, but let me just ask one question. Why do you think there is such fierce opposition to the idea of the Tobin tax? Which sounds like a no-brainer.
Well, I think it's... I didn't mention it because it's been going on so long. I think it really is a proof positive of the cancer system, the money sequence cancer system. Not us... iota of a tenth of 1% will be allowed back to you. So the Tobin tax, to me, just exemplifies the cancer, any more than a cancer will ever give up any part of the body that it's taken over. And that it makes, you know, such self-evident sense.
You'd think there'd be a great popular approval
for
that.
Well, there has been a great popular support of it. Now, of course, the mass media aren't going to support that popular movement, but there has been actually a long movement. I mean, this thing goes on 20 years. And the mass media are a joint stock company of corporate advertisers and the corporation investing in the mass media, and they all invest in the stock market, and all these equity funds, all these multiplying funds betting and that Peter described so well today, they're all vested in it. And so they don't much want it either if their stockbreakers don't want it. So I think you have, in a sense, a proof positive of something that's rational by an economist, a very well-known and good economist, even inside neoclassical framework, that we have an example of just how cancerous, unremittingly cancerous this system is.
Hi, John.
Hi.
Thanks for all your contribution to society, absolutely.
Thank you.
I'm Andrew. I'm the urban director of the New Earth Project. It's a sovereignty movement with over 1,000 square kilometers of land in a land trust that's moving towards incorporating concepts like the Jacques Fresco's test cities and self-sufficient systems as much as possible,
right,
and showcasing that to the world.
Right.
But wondered if you have any thoughts on the sovereignty movement, on people unplugging from...
I just think that the bottom line starts with the collective life capital that constitutes you as a people, or as in this case, as a land trust, and that it I mean, the thing about why I use the term capitalist is very unique in its concept of not only protecting, but through time, cumulative gain. So there's not only no loss, but there's cumulative gain built into the very process itself, which has been seized by financial capital, which is the perversion of it. And so I just think beginning from the, I mean, it takes, it took me a long time to really get to that bottom line of collective life capital, and I found it to work everywhere as a bottom line, even on your own life.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and so that trust could no better, I think, than begin with that as your bottom line. And then you get into, like, well, what? How are we making life better? How are we enabling life in a way that it wasn't enabled before, as well as protecting the reproduction and diversification and flourishing of life? And if you answer those questions in the positive, then you've got a good system.
Absolutely. Well, take a look at newearthnation.org sometime and have a look at, it's a lot of the train of thought and
yes.
Manifesting that through action.
Yes, there's a lot of overlap, but it's just what I'm, as a philosopher, looking for, ultimately regulating principles of fact and value. And that's why I commend the life, collective life capital principle, or the life capital principle itself, because it goes deeper as a unifying ground of thought and judgment than any other that I've seen.
It seems like a transition of increasing that while changing values in society. It kind of has to be done all simultaneously, well, or we're doing it now with
yes,
this.
Well, yes, well, you know, it applies to the thought sphere, the field of value of thought, and then thought, as I ended up with, thought carried into action, you're already covering most of what the human is good at. You know, but the felt side of being is what moves you, and so those three are all, and you can test, is it more coherently inclusive in its enabling? Then it's better. If it's not, if it's going the other direction, it's worse.
Thank you.
So it's a, yeah, thank you.
Hello, John, it was very erudite, your speech. Anyways, I'd like to ask you, this could equally go either to you or Peter, how do you remove the corporatocracy? Like a Nuremberg-style trial, or do you do it through design science, as Peter says? Like, what is the practical way of moving kind of forward and getting rid of it? That's
well, it can't get to step one without the public collaboration. That is of government collaboration. The government issues its charter. The government issues the banks with the right to multiply money they don't have as to hold on compounding debt on other people and so on. Is that, that's the point, is that the public reclaims what it is and what has been seized by it, and they really don't have anything else to go on. It's at that stage of capitalism where they're basically, having exhausted everything else, what their last buoyant base is the public taxation system, and ripping it out of that, and ripping it out of its natural resources.
So would that be like would that be like a citizens initiative? Would you get like kind of a GitHub of citizens to legislate them themselves and propose it to the government? Well, how could you do it?
Well, I mean, the one I recommend first is that we have a public banking option that is already built into the Canada Bank of Canada Act, for example, where the Bank of Canada, as it did during the war, lends to the government interest-free. You know, that's...
I agree, but yeah. Today, how could we do it? Like, say I wanted to reinitiate, or like, I guess, you know, revitalize this initiative. How could I do it? You know, me as John McMurtry, how would you do it?
Well, I'm a philosopher, so I try to do the most important action that I know of, which is the action of understanding, especially action of understanding where it isn't being understood. And so
I talk to my MP, I guess, or
well, that's a good idea. Yeah. That's a good one. I mean, there's many, many ways, many, many different types of individuals, but to know what the Bank of Canada Act actually says about lending to the government as one of its rights, which it refuses to deploy.
Thank you. Sorry. Thank you so much.
Yeah, you are.
Hi, John. Thanks.
Hi.
Thanks a lot for your talk.
Thank you.
As a professor, I was wondering what kind of support or...
Can you speak into the microphone?
Yeah, sure.
So other
side. As a professor, I was wondering what kind of support or resistance you have come across in your writing as well as your lectures from the university institution.
From the university institution itself?
Yeah.
Well, rocky roads at first, but not as because my work has been published all over the world, the United Nations, for example, uses my work, and I've been elected a fellow of the Royal Society, et cetera, all sorts of things have happened. Right from the beginning, though, that was the key, outside recognition. If I hadn't had outside of the university in which you work, the outside recognition, and that's the beauty of the university institution, is that it's not trapped within its own administrative bureaucracy by its principles, because you will have to have external, independent referees determine what the academic quality of somebody's work is. So it takes it out of the hands of always the local cabals and so forth that usually incompetents or mediocres. It takes it out of their hands, so it's entirely by outside recognition, most of which came as a wonderful gift. I didn't know it was going to happen, but did.
Thanks a lot.
So that's what, if you're working within there, and also when there's an issue, say we must have, as we do in all our process of validation, we must have an externally independent expert refereeing of whatever the issue is.
Terrific. Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Can I speak upon both your work and the whole work of the whole movement?
Sure.
So right now, you talk about the most important thing is changing as an individual. And I mean, any individual that's free to see the world for how it is or is educated enough to understand the things that we're all dealing with and addressing here, it's very clear to see that the world is in need of change. But I mean, we are lucky to live in a country where we have access to education, healthcare, and a number of different things, and most of the world doesn't even have this. And our country, still, we have to pay for education. Food, water, shelter is sold back to us as a commodity. How are individuals, normal individuals, the mass quantity of individuals supposed to get to that level of sophistication to understand these issues and change? Especially if people that are coming here are, as a collective already, are sort of understanding what's going on, and almost, I don't want to say preaching to the converted, but obviously the zeitgeist as a movement, as a whole, as an entity, is important to consolidate the resources to get it out to as many people as possible. But
well, first, you got to understand it.
Oh, I know.
And the understanding, if I were to say to you right now, well, what are the universal human life necessities and what is the criterion whereby we recognize them in our own lives? If you're not able to answer those questions, then you haven't really understood. And that's why I think the understanding is so very, very important.
It's extremely important.
Because those are criteria that have been worked out over the ages, really. And the act of understanding is the most important act of all.
This
is an educational movement.
And I agree. But my question is, how come the Zeitgeist movement hasn't branched out from just sort of consolidated forums like this to trying to breach the consciousness of the world as in many different venues as possible.
Well, I mean, how you do better than what Peter's done with his films.
And it's amazing, and the media is such a great way to engage the population, but still so many people see so many negative trends in the world and have such a huge pessimistic outlook on the rest of the future of the world. And I mean, this is why this movement's happening, to try to shift the psyche, really. But why aren't we as a collective or as a group addressing making political parties or executing different venues?
I'm an invited speaker. I'm not a part
of
these
not.
Zeitgeist leadership.
All right. Thank you. They're going to answer these questions later.
Thank you so much for coming tonight.
Thank you.